Gold retains record highs on escalating Middle East tensions. Hi, everyone, and welcome to Ainslie Insights, brought to you by Ainslie Bullion, Ainslie Crypto, and the Gold and Silver Standard as the Ainslie Group celebrates 50 years. Today, we welcome back Brenko, who's been digging deep with his analysis into the recent turmoil in the Middle East and how it's impacting the gold market specifically. How are you going today, Brenko?
Yeah, good. I think today's topic is probably dominating world headlines, so we'll just focus on how it pertains to gold and assets and ignore kind of the politics of it. But yeah, it's quite a turbulent time right now, and yeah, it's pretty insane.
It certainly has been dominating headlines, and I was actually curious as I was starting to look at this and looking at what you're writing that, you know, it is a question of how much of this is actually attributable to what's going on in the Middle East versus or the geopolitical tensions generally that we've been seeing, and how much is coming out of that economic data out of the US, because it seems like there's really quite a lot going on all at once. It's like always in macro, you get nothing for a while and then everything happens all at once. What's your take on the sort of split there between what's going on for the geopolitical side and what's going on just because of the economic data side?
Yeah, I think the geopolitical side is generally where we're going to see these big moves, you know, which I've referred to in the past. But like, for example, when Russia bombed Ukraine like 2 years ago and we've been in the office and it was just chaos, like gold just shot up, everything's gone crazy. So those events, like we saw this week, when those events happen, it's going to be significant moves. Those significant moves are most likely, you know, related to these geopolitical situations. And I think that gives gold good upside in that if you do get these crazy things happen, it's going to see the spike. And the economic data is kind of baked in and priced in. And that's like what's going to set up the fundamentals, I think, for precious metals. So I think, yeah, in general, this move was obviously geopolitical, but that economic data is kind of baked into more the fundamental side.
And that's a fair assessment, because we sort of have seen that, particularly on the ground in the office. We've seen that it got really busy yesterday when people were coming to sort of rush in and take what they see as whether advantage of that opportunity or whether they're wanting to protect against potential escalation. It was all on yesterday. It starts to ease off a little bit as the news settles. But I noticed in what you're writing that Goldman Sachs forecasts, they're raising their forecast to 2,900 for early 2025. Do you think that is optimistic? Do you think that there's risks to that prediction, or is it pretty much spot on?
I mean, I think it's looking pretty good now after what we saw. We talked about that a couple of days ago, but it's interesting that, you know, for them to increase it, and I think it was written before I'll have to double check, it was written before the actual Iran retaliation. So not saying that they predicted it, but they probably, as a part of their modeling, would have anticipated some further escalation of the Middle East, you know, turmoil. So I think it's looking pretty spot on. And I mean, if you know, it's like any pullback we have, we can put up a chart in a sec, but any pullback we have just gets immediately bought up in gold. And I think it's just a product of, you know, people seeing the upside that it has and the common, you know, the common and the positive things it has going for it right now.
So given, obviously, we've got that stuff that's happening in the Middle East, we've got the conflict aspect of it, but also the economic indicators that we're talking about. Do you think that there is potentially a mixed signal coming there? Because we've had somewhat strong data in the jobs area. We're not quite sure yet. We'll see more data coming out later in the week. But we've also had weaker manufacturing data come out that we just got recently. So we're really in that sort of no man's land in the middle that potentially gives the Federal Reserve fuel for continuing their rate decisions. Not really sure. What's your take on the Fed's impact on gold here over the coming months?
Yeah, so I think that the first point, again, is this jobs data, as we discussed time and time again. Most likely, especially given how close we are to the election, about 5 weeks away, in about 6 weeks, we're going to see the data just get revised down. Yeah. So yeah. I think the data is actually going to be more closely aligned to, you know, a more negative view of the economy, which probably will help gold. So that's kind of the first point I think is important there, that this, you know, over 8 million new job openings, expect that to come down. So that'll better align with the manufacturing data. And I think that as we can get into shortly as well, I think that this is a very unique time in gold's bull market because of where the interest rates are. So I think overall it's quite positive.
And speaking of that, and we'll talk about the historical time you mentioned in the article, the one in 1979, we had very high inflation. Is it different this time around, or are you seeing a comparison there? Because you certainly made one in the article that we might be seeing a cycle similar to that unfold here.
Yeah, so this is a Peter Schiff point that he mentioned on Schwab Network the other day. I think it's a great point. Is that, you know, the last time we saw this gold bull market was when they had to keep rising rates up. So we haven't really seen a market like this where rates are going to get cut for gold when it's in this bullish state. So I think that is honestly quite significant because, you know, as we know, it means that people are going to have more, you know, sort of money to invest with rates going down, where in the past it was the other way. So the comparison to its last bull market in 79 is very different. And if anything, it's even more bullish now. I mean, obviously, just given the political tension, the rate situation and the general fundamentals, you know, we had the central banks buying as well. So it is quite different and, dare I say, even better than the last bull market.
And certainly the debt situation was correct, like much, much higher than what it was back then.
Yeah.
So to wrap this up, obviously a lot of things going on, as we've talked about, but specifically on this idea of escalating conflict in the Middle East, if we focus back in on that again, and people are looking for safe haven assets because gold certainly has performed that role, silver to some extent as well, for a very long time.
Yeah.
What should they be looking for in terms of making a decision there? If gold is going to potentially push much higher, we've had those higher predictions, what could cause a correction? What's your general advice to people when they're thinking in that frame about precious metals in this environment?
Yeah, I think the difficult thing with precious metals is, and I think this is kind of in the office, you kind of see this, is when you have these big events, you do have like this, you know, insane rush to buy. And often a lot of those people might buy at the top because they might buy when kind of the event happens, which in this case, you know, could be the Iran retaliation. So I think the difficult point is figuring out the best time to buy. And a lot of times, you know, if you are interested in buying precious metals, it could be in these quieter periods before we get the next kind of escalation. Now, the situation we have now is very unique because it feels like an escalation is almost around the corner. So even though we just had this most recent escalation, given kind of what Netanyahu has been saying, a retaliation could be coming, you know, you might see another spike in gold just because of, you know, the next big thing. So it might not always be the most profitable thing to buy kind of when everyone else is buying and when the panic is setting in. However, given the unique situation we are in now, that might be a more viable strategy than it's been in the past, if that makes sense.
Yeah, fair enough. And an interesting sort of anecdote on that as well is what you often see with these events when they happen over a weekend, for example, it can escalate, like it can add a multiple on top of that because the markets aren't open. So you get to Monday morning and there's just this mad rush of buying and selling to balance the market out from what's happened over the weekend. So something like that can happen. I think the advice you sort of said before about these quieter periods can actually be the better times to accumulate makes a lot of sense because you the gaps between escalations could be the time if you're looking to do that rather than right on the day that something happens. But
yeah, generally, I agree that these gaps are the best time. But I do have the caveat that this is very unique in that I think Netanyahu is already kind of saying we're going to retaliate. And if they do retaliate, it can only be priced in so much. You know, I think it's unlikely that if there's a retaliation that gold would go down just because there'd be more panic buying. So, yeah, it's a very difficult time. And then with rates the way they are, I think, yeah, it's super complex and overall, I think, positive for precious metals.
Agree with that one. Thanks, Branko, for your work on that today. I think we'll be certainly paying attention and value the fact that you're watching it so closely. So thank you for that.
Thanks.
Thanks, everyone, for watching. We'll chat again soon.